Good evening. Thank you. Good evening. I'm Jennifer Rabb and have the extraordinary privilege of being the president of this wonderful institution, Hunter College. It is a pleasure to welcome you to the opening of this Presidential Leadership Forum, Revisiting the Great Society and the Role of Government from FDR to LBJ to today. Given the close ties between Hunter College and the Roosevelts, there could be no more appropriate setting for this historic conference. Roosevelt House, Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt's New York City home, where they lived from their marriage to his inauguration, is just 3 blocks from Hunter College. A wonderful bond was created back in the 1920s between these neighbors, and it was FDR himself who suggested that Hunter buy the house after his mother, Sarah, who also lived with them there, but that is another story, died in 1941. Franklin donated the first $1,000 to Hunter towards the $50,000 purchase price. As stewards of this historic and architectural gem, we celebrate the significant events that happened in this home. During the 4 hectic months between the 1932 election and the 1933 inauguration, many of FDR's signature programs, unemployment insurance, public works, other examples, were hatched in its halls. It was in his library on the second floor of Roosevelt House that FDR asked Frances Perkins to serve as his Secretary of Labor, making her the first woman to serve in a presidential cabinet. She accepted on one condition, that he supports Social Security, the cornerstone of the New Deal. And so how wonderful that many of you will spend tomorrow at Roosevelt House discussing the Great Society in the rooms that gave birth to the New Deal. The ties run even deeper, though, because as many of you know, Franklin Roosevelt was Lyndon Johnson's mentor and his hero. FDR gave LBJ his first big federal position in 1935, making him the Texas director of a national program to help young people stay in school and get job training. Johnson did such a masterful job that the Texas Project became a model for the nation, and in 1936, FDR went down to have a firsthand look. Witnesses say Roosevelt threw his head back and roared with laughter as his motorcade passed a roadside project where Johnson had his boys saluting the president with shovels at present arms. It was after this trip that FDR made a fateful prediction to Harold Ickes. In the next generation, he said, the balance of power will shift south and west, and this boy, meaning Johnson, could well be the first Southern president since the Civil War. Roosevelt did all he could to make this prediction come true. He played a pivotal role in helping young Lyndon win his first election to Congress and served as a mentor and confidant. The depth of their bond was captured in LBJ's mournful quote to the New York Times after Roosevelt's death. Johnson said, "He was just like a daddy to me, always." FDR and LBJ's belief in the positive power of government is reflected in Hunter's commitment to promote civic engagement as a part of a liberal arts education. Ever since its founding in 1870, Hunter, as a public institution, has provided a gateway to the American dream for immigrants, minorities, and the children of working class families, most of them the first in their families to go to college. We train our students to be grateful for what society has provided for them and urge them to fulfill the Hunter motto, mihi cura futuri, the care of the future is mine. And so we are grateful to host a spectacular conference linking FDR to LBJ and thank the many people who made it possible. I want to single out 2 in particular, Jonathan Fanton and Joseph Califano. As our interim director, Jonathan has played a transformational role in creating a world-class public policy institute at Roosevelt House. He had the vision to recruit Joe Califano to serve on our advisory board, and Joe had the genius to propose this conference. Together, they secured the funds and recruited the extraordinary list of participants, including 2 of America's most beloved figures, George McGovern and Walter Mondale, here tonight. And Joe, on a personal note, thank you not just for this program, but being a lifelong inspiration. When you were the secretary, I was a graduate student intern at the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare. That was a time when a federal intern was still an innocent position. You were an outstanding example of a great public servant then, and I am still learning from you now. Now it is a great pleasure to introduce two very special stewards of the LBJ legacy. The first is LBJ's remarkable daughter, Lucy Baines Johnson. Lucy, you've done so much to perpetuate and to protect your father's great legacy. Please stand so we can recognize your contributions. Such an honor to have you. And now it is an honor to bring to the stage Mark Updegrove, director of the Johnson Presidential Library and Museum. Mark is an award-winning historian. His third book on the American presidency, Indomitable Will, LBJ and the Presidency, will be released this week. Mark, we look forward to reading this important work. As fellow stewards of presidential legacies, it has been an honor to work with you and the LBJ Library and to welcome you here tonight. Mark Updegrove.
Thank you, President Rapp. It is altogether appropriate that this conference be held at Hunter College and at Roosevelt House, where we will convene tomorrow. Lyndon Johnson, as President Rapp mentioned, was a protege of Franklin Roosevelt, who served as president when LBJ was first elected to Congress in 1936. LBJ, a New Dealer by background and at heart, believed in FDR and his vision for America. In many ways, the seeds of LBJ's great society were planted in the fields of FDR's New Deal. As Johnson often said to his aides during his administration, "I really intend to finish Franklin Roosevelt's revolution." But LBJ's passion for social justice came well before FDR landed in the White House. In 1965, before a joint session of Congress, LBJ talked about an experience as a young man that may have been among the most formative of his life.
My first job after college was as a teacher in Cotulla, Texas, in a small Mexican-American school. Few of them could speak English, and I couldn't speak much Spanish. My students were poor, and they often came to class without breakfast, hungry. And they knew, even in their youth, the pain of prejudice. They never seemed to know why people disliked them, but they knew it was so, because I saw it in their eyes. I often walked home late in the afternoon after the classes were finished, wishing there was more that I could do. But all I knew was to teach them the little that I knew, hoping that it might help them against the hardships that lay ahead. And somehow you never forget what poverty and hatred can do when you see its scars on the hopeful face of a young child. I never thought then, in 1928, that I would be standing here in 1965. It never even occurred to me in my fondest dreams that I might have the chance to help the sons and daughters of those students and to help people like them all over this country. But now I do have that chance. And I'll let you in on a secret. I mean to use it.
With memories of those Mexican-American school children seared in his conscience and racial strife alive and well in America in the mid-1960s, LBJ took his own revolution where FDR had not, enlisting in the cause of civil rights and determined to put a legal end to racial apartheid in America. On November 25, 1963, on what was the second full day of his presidency, Johnson called Martin Luther King Jr. and initiated what would become among the most productive and important partnerships of the 20th century.
A good many people told me that they heard about your statement, I guess, on TV, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right.
I've been locked up in this office, and I haven't seen it, but I won't tell you how grateful I am and how worthy I'm going to try to be of all your hopes.
Well, thank you very much. I'm so happy to hear that, and I knew that you had just that great spirit, and you know you have our support and backing.
Well,
we know what a difficult period this is.
It's just an impossible period. We got a budget coming up that's got nothing to do with it. It's practically already made, and we got a civil rights bill that hadn't even passed the House, and it's November, and Hubert Humphrey told me yesterday everybody wanted to go home. We got a tax bill that they haven't touched. We just got to not let up on any of them and keep going, and I guess they'll say that I'm repudiated, but I'm going to ask the Congress Wednesday to just stay there till they pass them all. They won't do it, but we'll just keep them there next year till they do, and we just won't give up an inch.
Well, this is mighty fine. I think it's so imperative. I think one of the great tributes that we can pay in memory of President Kennedy is to try to enact some of the great progressive policies that he sought to initiate.
Well, I'm going to support them all, and you can count on that, and I'm going to do my best to get other men to do likewise, and I'll have to have y'all's help. I never needed more than I do now.
Well, you know you have it, and just feel free to call on us for anything.
Thank you so much, Martin.
All right.
Call me when you... I sure will. Call me when you're down here next time.
I certainly will.
But let's get together, and any suggestions you got, bring them in.
Fine. I certainly will do that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All men are created equal is an inherent part of the American creed. By working with Martin Luther King and others towards the Civil Rights Acts of 1964 and 1968, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and other civil rights measures, LBJ, more than any other president, helped to fulfill the promise of equal rights for all Americans. That legislation came at a cost. When Johnson's friend and mentor, Democratic Senator Richard Russell of Georgia, warned him that passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 would result in the Democratic Party's loss in the southern states and his loss of the presidency in the fall election, Johnson replied, "If that is the price for this bill, I will gladly pay it." In fact, the Democrats did lose the South, but Johnson won the election of 1964 in a landslide. He used that mandate to fulfill other promises, enacting Medicare, Head Start, federal aid to education, immigration reform, environmental conservation, and taking measures to weaken poverty's hold in America, as the poverty rate plunged from 20% to 12% during the course of his administration. The Great Society might have swept even further into American life if not for the mire of Vietnam, a conflict Johnson inherited from Presidents Eisenhower and Kennedy. As LBJ escalated the war with no resolution in sight, divisions spread throughout the country. On any given day in the latter part of his presidency, protesters could be heard outside of the White House gates chanting, "Hey, hey, LBJ, how many kids did you kill today?" LBJ agonized over the war, which resulted in the loss of 36,000 U.S. troops by the time he ended his White House reign in 1969. But as this conference will reflect, LBJ's formidable legacy of liberty continues to resonate, uniting us today far beyond the divisions of yesteryear. "Come, let us reason together," was Johnson's favorite biblical passage. By reaching across the aisle, appealing to reason, and fostering togetherness, he not only continued FDR's revolution, but left his own indelible mark on America. While he may have been the consummate politician, his ultimate aim was to use his power to do the greatest good for the greatest number. Hey, hey, LBJ, my oh my, we could use you today. One of Johnson's chief architects in building his great society was a young New Yorker named Joe Califano, who served as a special assistant to the president from 1965 to 1969. He then went on to become Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare for Jimmy Carter. He is currently an advisory board member for the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute, and as President Rabb mentioned, a catalyst for this conference. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming to the stage Joe Califano.
Thank you.